Hallelujah. Hey, we got a great show planned for you today, and we're going to be doing something a lot different than usual. And I'm going to appreciate your feedback because, again, we're trying new things. Our desire here is to improve our quality and give you even a greater experience in what we're doing. So today we're going to be looking at the reality of the feast. We celebrated Easter here, about a month ago. But most people may not know that, we celebrate Easter because that's, I'm not even sure how they pick that from a natural perspective. But what we celebrate with Easter is the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus. And that happened at a very specific time in Jewish history. And the Bible tells us to commemorate that time at a very specific time. And it's based on lunar cycles and the days of the month. And today on our show, I have two friends that I've known them for a number of years, Gary and Gloria Vande Kamps. Matter of fact, we've done meetings together. And this coming week in Tulsa, they are doing a Passover Seder. So my hope here is today to help you understand the significance of the Jewish feast. In the Bible, God tells us very clearly that the Jews were to celebrate the feast at a particular time. And there's four spring feasts, and then there's a three fall feasts. The first four feasts were fulfilled again through the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus. And then after the resurrection, 50 days later, came Pentecost. And so that all that was fulfilled, and that was fulfilled literally when Moses came down with the law from on the mountaintop there. We'll learn more about that today. But anyway, Gary and Gloria are here with us in our studio. And I'm going to invite them to tell you, and we're just going to have a conversation here about what's happening this particular weekend all over the world as Jews, Messianic Jews, and many Christians with them are celebrating the death, burial, and resurrection according to Jewish custom. So I'm going to invite Gary here in just a moment to play the shofar. And at the end of the show, you're going to have a real special treat in that they have a dance company, and it's just beautiful to watch. And they brought a little clip of a video they did in a previous Seder here in Tulsa. You'll see their dance troupe, dance company. And then Gary and Gloria are going to do a bridal dance, I guess you'd call it. They'll tell us more about that. So I'd like you to welcome with me to the Living Supernatural Studio here, Gary and Gloria Vande Kamps. Well, praise God. Hey, guys, welcome.
And
as we were just getting set here to turn on the camera, Gary said, did you say Vande Kamps or Vande Kamps? And I probably said it wrong. Hard to imagine. I can make a mistake. Actually, I made three of them yesterday. yesterday morning. But it's Vande Kamps. Mm-hmm. And Gary, you're gonna blow the shofar here for us. Before you do, tell us, what's the significance? This is a beautiful piece of musical instrument.
The Lord provided the lamb, or the ram in this case. Abraham, as the story goes, Abraham was supposed to sacrifice his son Yitzchak, or Isaac, and I say Abraham, that's a Hebrew word for Abraham, but anyway, after the Lord says, stop, don't, it's okay, I know yet your heart is with me, you don't have to sacrifice him. Then he seen the ram in the thicket, and then he said, the Lord provided the ram. And that was at Har Mount Moriah, and And that's the same place where Yeshua, or Jesus, one day would be the sacrifice. And
right.
So he was the sacrifice. Stop! I'm the sacrifice. It's okay.
So is that when the blowing of the shofar started? Probably not.
That's the way the story goes, but they could have used it a lot of times to signal, you know, like the beginning of the new moons and that type of thing. But it was the first initial instrument used for the sounding forth of the calls, different calls, symbolic of call to assembly or call to war or call to march. So different sounds connected with that.
So today, as you're going to treat us to blowing it, after you do it before you do it so well, what's the significance, right, Todd? Now, when you do it today, what's going to happen? Why would we want to do this?
It's symbolic of the Lord's voice, and that's why he had to do that. Because when they used the calling of the assembly, it wasn't just man calling, it was God through the authority, and they used the instrument to assemble, like I said, and to go to war or go to get into the march. So it was a symbolic thing. And in Numbers, or Bamidbar 10, it talks about if you sound the trumpet, and it was talking about the silver trumpet, so shall you be saved from your enemies. Mm. And so that's a wonderful faith thing to, you know, to do and to believe. So hallelujah.
So maybe you can tell me, when I hear the shofar, it just does something in my spirit.
Hallelujah.
I mean, it does. It's just like, woo! I'm ready to take off.
It's like the ruach blowing through it.
Yeah.
And the enemy does not know who is blowing it, if it's the Lord, if it's an angel, or if it's man, but he flees.
Yeah.
He has to flee.
All right.
Typically, and normally I would, a lot of times I do, is to put a tallit around myself, cover myself, and all you see is the shofar, because you're supposed to just see the Lord.
Oh.
So.
Well, we didn't plan this ahead. I just happen to know you have one of these, so I asked Gary to do this. So, Gary, can you honor us with doing this?
Sure.
All right.
Mm. Hallelujah. Okay, first the call. Hallelujah. Call to assembly. Hallelujah. The Lord is calling his people. Hallelujah. And then the call to warfare, or to get us assembled into a line, according to Numbers 10. And on the Feast of Trumpets, they'll do that 100 times. Hallelujah. To draw attention, to get lives in order. Hallelujah. Because Yeshua could come. Hallelujah. Especially during this high holy time, which is unfulfilled yet at this point. But one day he will, we believe, come at this season of the year, at Feast of Trumpets.
All right.
I could do one more. The shofar Haggadol. It's the grand blast. And I think the Lord probably has one big, huge ram's horn that he's going to blow, that's going to be heard around the world, just like as it's believed that he did at the giving of the Torah at Har Mount Sinai. Hallelujah. Sinai. Praise you, Lord. Hallelujah. So it's just a long blast, not for show or anything, just to hold the note for a long time, because something is great is going to happen, and gadol is a Hebrew word for great.
You know, if that doesn't get somebody's spiritual motor going, I'm not sure what would. Glory to God. Well, now, you guys have a messianic synagogue. Is that correct?
Congregation we go by usually. Yeah.
Okay, so it's not really...
We don't want to make it just Christian or Jewish, just synagogue or assembly. Yeah.
So congregation. Synagogue would mean just Jewish.
Right.
So, mm-hmm. But you guys are Messianic.
Right.
But you're really not Jewish.
Well,
you are. I mean, we're grafted in.
Well, but we probably have Jewish ancestry too.
Okay.
We're just not 100%.
All right.
We did a genealogy test one time and it showed some there.
Right.
So we know we have some, and we saw the trace going through the Middle East. They usually show the journeys of the blood that you have and
okay.
did a saliva test. And so it showed us going through from Austria through the Middle East, Israel, and then up to the Netherlands, which is interesting. We also have Dutch background. My grandfather, I found out, had housed the Jews during the Holocaust. So they had a very close relationship with the Jewish people anyway. Maybe the Lord was drawing his heart, but he would talk about the feast, different things when he was alive. And it stirred my attention. And when we were filled in the Spirit, the Holy Spirit is so amazing, but he drew us immediately to our Jewish roots after we were filled with the Spirit. Mm. And he said to start studying all the feasts. Now, no one around us was teaching all of this.
Yes.
We didn't have any Messianic congregations back there. So it was truly the Holy Spirit that opened up the Scriptures to us and taught us. And I look back at my notes back then, and it was amazing how the Holy Spirit is so awesome to open up the Scriptures. But that's what the Holy Spirit does. He opens the Scriptures mm-hmm. to help you understand the depths of his love for us and the truths that he wants you to know.
So then as you begin to discover your mm-hmm. your own personal Jewish roots and the roots of all of us, really,
yeah.
you decided to mm-hmm. have a Messianic mm-hmm. congregation.
Yeah, and you don't need Jewish blood to be a pastor of a Messianic congregation. It's just, like you said, really, it's one who seeks Yah or Yeshua, the Jewish name for Jesus, the biblical name and what his mother called him. If you have a heart for that, that's what it takes. There's a lot of people who have been grafted in, including people in the Bible. Caleb was one. Caleb, the right-hand man, really, of Yehoshua, a man mm-hmm. of faith. But because he was a Kenite, he couldn't be the leader. But they really looked to him.
I didn't know that.
Yeah.
Caleb wasn't the Jew.
No.
Wow.
He grafted in. When they came out of Egypt, he says, I want to be with that people, that group of people. They're winners.
Wow. I learned something new. That's awesome to know that. So, all right. So, we are celebrating as Jews, or grafted in Jews, this weekend, the Jewish feast. Tell mm-hmm. us what's going on.
Okay, can I just qualify that real quick? Jew, the Hebrew word is Yehuda, and it's a praiser of Yah. And that's anybody that loves the Lord, Jesus, Yeshua, you know, both names is a Yehuda, or a Jew,
okay.
In a sense. So,
good.
You know, so anyway, what's coming up this weekend? Passover?
Okay, now, you know, again, as I mentioned in the introduction, we celebrated pretty much around the world, I guess. I'm not sure. Do you know how they picked the dates for Easter?
It goes by the solar calendar, which is the sun, and the Romans did that with the Roman calendar and that, but it wasn't originally that way at the beginning of time. It wasn't that way at the time of Israel. Those are two different calendars, a secular calendar that everybody went by. And probably the first day of it was started at the fall, and it was thought that the earth was created, mm-hmm. and later on when Israel became a nation, it's like a spiritual birthday. They really became cleaved to the Lord because he betrothed them. Then they had the spiritual calendar, which began in the spring, and that's really what we go by now, especially if you're a saved people.
So, when you say they became a nation, are we speaking coming out of Egypt
yes,
at that
uh-huh,
point?
Uh-huh.
Because we also had them becoming a nation in 1948.
Right.
So when they came out of Egypt is when God ordained
yes.
the appointed seasons of feast.
Right, and we were talking earlier, it's likely there was appointments going on before, and that's why certain days had special significance, like when you were mentioning the ark of Noah came to rest at a certain day in the spring. So.
Yep, 7th month, 17th day, which happens to be, when you look at it from the Jewish religious calendar, as opposed to the chronological calendar.
Yeah, chronological.
Civil calendar, and then a religious calendar.
Yep, right.
But anyway, so God told them to celebrate Passover on, was it the 14th of Nisan? Is that right? 14th of Nisan?
Nisan or of Nisan?
Nisan.
Yeah.
Not like the car Nisan.
Nisan. Well, so. Yeah. I guess so.
On the 14th of Nisan is when they celebrated, the Jews celebrated Passover.
Uh-huh.
And as I understand it, that's when Jesus was actually crucified.
Right.
On Passover. So
right.
you got there. The Pharisees and the Sadducees, and they're at one end of town killing a lamb.
That they were killing the lambs when Yeshua was being
and then Jesus being expired. The Passover lamb was actually crucified on Passover.
Mm-hmm.
And then when they came out of Egypt, in the book of Numbers or Exodus there, it says they were to commemorate, remember this day.
Mm-hmm.
And that event became something they've been doing. We still do ever since.
Yes.
So now your Messianic congregation is celebrating Passover this weekend, and you have I've been to a few of these over the years. A Seder. So tell us what happens in a Seder.
Okay. Well, the Seder is a Hebrew word for order, and there's certain things that you really need to do, and like the four cups, the cup of sanctification. The cup of judgment, and the cup of redemption, and the cup of praise. So it really talks all about the complete picture of the salvation and so forth, and what we all need to do to prepare for it. We need to sanctify ourselves, and the Lord has passed judgment. It's passed over us because of the blood of the Lamb, Yeshua, and the cup of redemption. He celebrated that after the supper with the disciples, and this do as often as ye, or this as often as ye do it in remembrance of me, remembering what I have done for you, and that I have redeemed you from all your sins. They were redeemed in Egypt from the plagues and from slavery, and now we're redeemed from the slavery of sin and all kinds of bondages, every enslavement, and then the cup of praise, where we're just rejoicing because we live with the Lord forevermore.
Praise God. Now, the Seders that I have been to, as I understood them, and don't always say I understand things right, but as I remember my understanding, the Seder was a reenactment, per se, of what Jews have done
exactly
for 3,000 years, basically.
Yeah.
But it's interesting, as they're going through their... their rituals, which we remember, I mean, just as we're doing a Seder, it all points to Jesus.
It does.
Everything. So now when people come, by the way, their event's going to be, for those of you that can make it in Tulsa on Saturday, it starts at 1 o'clock. And you're located at
8600 South Lewis Avenue.
8600 South Lewis Avenue.
Uh-huh.
And it officially starts at 1 o'clock.
1 o'clock. And we encourage you to come early.
You want to get there early.
Yeah.
So you're not...
There's things that, you know, we do with the different stations and so forth so that everyone can start at 1 o'clock. It would be nice.
And it's all part of remembering what happened basically 3,000, 4,000 years ago. So what are those stations? What happens?
Well, we get to, now no one's required to do everything, but you're definitely encouraged. There's something about just going through an enactment of what they did, like putting the blood on the doorpost. It's not actual blood, but just a symbolic thing. Actually, the elements of communion, the Lord's Supper, is just elements. It's a symbol. And so And so we're putting the blood on, we were acting like we're putting the blood on the doorpost, and the Lord, of course, then can pass over. We're having our hands washed, symbolic of us being cleansed. A good example is when Kepha Peter refused to have his foot washed, but because he says, "I want to wash your feet, Yeshua." And Yeshua says, "I just have to wash your feet and you're all cleansed." So that's, and it's a good practice, isn't it? It's a sanitary thing, and it's amazing. I usually don't need soap if I just get my hands washed by someone. And people are praying a lot of times too as you're getting your hands washed. And as we know, we're all blessed by prayer. Hallelujah.
Yes.
And then we have, there'll be registration, tickets, and then going in and fellowship, finding the place that you wanted to sit by, and your friends. And of course, if you come with a different amount of friends and so forth, you can sit at the same table. But if you've come for the first time, you really don't know anything about Passover, then you may want to go to a table where there's someone that does, and then we'll help lead you through it. And we'll have it all on the PowerPoint that you'll be able to see, and we'll go through the everything together. Well, Gloria and I will be up front and going through the different parts of the Seder. So
just coming in, though, you start with taking a piece of hyssop of sort and doing that, and then going to the washing station. But then during the actual Seder itself, there's a lot of little things that are involved in. Yeah. A handkerchief and taking a piece of the matzah bread, and then the bitter herbs and the horseradish. And you know, I thought a Seder was a meal. And it's not
an appetizer.
Well, there's really not much eating there. It's a lot of ceremony.
Yes.
But very, very interesting to see all our points to Jesus.
Right.
Yeah. But then the ones I've been to, then after the Seder, they have actually a meal. I presume you have that as well.
Yeah, it's right in the middle. And that's why we try to do it like Yeshua did when he had this last one with his disciples. And of course, after supper, the third cup came, the cup of redemption. And there are things that we'll have at the table, especially if you're taking children. They're not going to always be waiting for that main meal. So we do have other things on the table that they can eat. Healthy things. We're really big on that. So natural health. And so, hallelujah.
Yeah, we plan to have lamb and chicken and lots of good things.
Yeah. So is there a cost for this? I'm buying a ticket, I would presume.
Yes, $15, and for an adult, 6 to 12 is 10, and 3 to 5 is $5, and of course under that are free.
And they can buy a ticket at the door when they come in.
All right.
They can, but they're encouraged to buy it before, so we know how many are coming, so we can set it up for you.
At least call and let us know.
So what number would people that are in the Tulsa area that wanted to participate, what number would they call?
918-408-6689.
Okay, we'll get that on the screen there again. One more time.
918-408-6689.
All righty, so if you're in Tulsa this Saturday, 1 o'clock, you can join in on this activity. And I asked them, why 1 o'clock? I mean, is that the holiest time? And you said no. It could be any time, really, right?
Yeah, 24-hour span.
Yeah.
So give us an understanding of time.
Well, the reason we did that is for the children. We are a family congregation, and we have several little ones. Mm-hmm. And if we do it into the evening, it gets into their sleep time, and they're the freshest, the most alert. We also have a little Passover Torah video for the children, so they'll get to see puppets.
Yes, I really like it.
And explain the whole little sequence of Passover in 3 minutes. And then we have
I might like to see that.
Yeah, it's awesome.
Adults would like it. It's a family congregation. Yeah.
Normally on Shabbat, we have Amanda teach the children shortly after our videos on Shabbat. And she does an excellent job. So she's going to be there and ask the children questions if they listened well to the video. Mm-hmm. And also about the Seder. Mm-hmm. And then we have a special dance we do of blessing around the children after that. One little boy has his birthday that day, so we're going to honor him, and it'll just be a special time. But Passover is a family event. We don't want to discourage children from coming. We want the whole family there to enjoy. And it says, in fact, tell your children the story of Passover. So that's, we want to carry it from generation to generation.
So some places do it on Friday. I mean, the Seders I've been to, they've been on Friday night. But tell people how the day is picked.
Some people try to be practical, and we've done this too before. We try to keep it on the day, which is the 14th of the first spiritual month.
So the first month, and the first spiritual month.
Of Eve or Nisan,
Okay, so that's the new thing. That's the new one. God instituted when they came out of Egypt. That was the first day of the year, in month of Nisan, where previously it was like October or September. Tishri, if I say that right. So God said to have it, celebrate Passover. How do they pick that day? It's on the 14th of Nisan, I understand.
Well, they, after the moon cycle is completed, then it's no moon and the sliver of the moon, and that would confirm the new month starting. But being it's the first month of the year, the barley's got to be about ready. This year it wasn't ready, but there's been calendars calculated now. I think even Hillel in the third century or so had calculated. So we pretty much know when the season will be right for the barley to be ready. And they have spotters that do that. And so they're able to determine. Now this year we had 13 months. Well, we just came into it. The last year was 13 months in the calendar. So it was a little later, and that's why we fell after the Christians' Easter celebration. So, otherwise they're usually on the same weekend.
And you just kind of blew my mind here. I mean, I'm learning some new things here. We had 13 months. How does that happen?
Because the barley was not ready in Israel at that time. They have spotters looking to see if the barley is ready. That's the first harvest. And that's around the time that we celebrate Passover. But if the Aviv, or the spring, harvest is not ready, you can't celebrate that, because on Resurrection Day you have to take the first sheaf of that first harvest and wave it. And if it's not ready, you can't wave it.
And Yeshua is the first fruit. It represents, when you wave the barley, you're waving really what Yeshua has done for us. He's the first fruit of those risen from the dead. And that's what we do on the Sunday after, the day after the Sabbath, on that week of Holy Week of Unleavened Bread.
So what is the 13th month called? Is it not Nisan then?
Adar
2. Yeah.
Adar 2.
Two months of Adar.
How often does that happen?
Just to keep it even, because there's only 28 or 29 days of the month in a Hebrew month. It wouldn't work out very well. So every so often they have to have 13 months to make up for it. And so as the Roman calendar, once in a while you get, of course, a different day, extra day in the second month of February. But
the leap year, too.
Okay. Wow, most interesting.
Roman calendars, they got 30, 31, sometimes 28. So that's how that works.
All right, so in the Jewish calendar, then we're going to celebrate this thing. So we had two Adairs. Adair 1, Adair 2. So then, now we go to the month of Nisan. So it's the, and that starts based on the moon, the new moon. So then on the 14th is when the crucifixion happened. That's Passover. And then how do they calculate Resurrection Day?
It's 3 days after the Sabbath. It's 3 days after Passover usually, but it always falls the day after Sabbath during unleavened bread, which is 7 days. So, and of course, when Yeshua walked the earth, when he gave up his life, it was on a fourth day of the week, which would be Wednesday, and 3 days and three nights in the belly of the earth. He rose sometime during the night after Shabbat. So
And Shabbat is the first day
Sabbath,
of the week.
The seventh day of the week.
Seventh day of the week. Okay.
Right.
So that would be Saturday.
Right.
And that's when Jews typically celebrate church.
And so, a lot of believers too, yeah.
Yeah. That's true. That's true. So
and
it starts
the fourth
at,
commandment says, keep my Shabbat.
Right.
You know?
Yeah.
So it's never, you know, God is the same yesterday, today, and forever. So
right. And there's no scripture verse. It was so important to change the Sabbath to the first day of the week. The Lord, I believe, would have said something.
So, but you mentioned something as we were getting ready to go to recording here about this being a high day.
Right, during the Holy Week. There are two holy weeks of the year, spring and fall.
Okay.
When most of the feasts fall in.
But you said something about this Saturday is exceptionally different.
Well, at the close of Shabbat is the first Sabbath of the Feast of Unleavened Bread. It says in Leviticus to have a holy convocation and not do any work on the first and seventh day of the Feast of Unleavened Bread, because God wants you to get together and assemble and learn of Him. And so the seventh day is going to be a high holy day because it falls on Shabbat.
Okay.
And the Shabbat, of course, it's a holy day, but when you have two Shabbats on the same day, which is the last day of the feast, that's going to be an exceptional.
The seventh day Sabbath falls on the seventh day Sabbath. The seventh day of the Sabbath of the feast falls on the seventh day Sabbath of the seventh day of the week. So it makes it a double Sabbath.
So that makes a Saturday awesome.
Yes.
Yeah.
Amen. So you want to assemble for sure and see what God does. You know, it's a divine appointment. It's like a date with the Lord, and you want to hear what He has to say.
Praise God.
Yeah, and none of this is legalistic. You know, we just want to do what Yeshua would do. You know, a lot of people wear what would Jesus do buttons. We just want to do what Jesus would do if He was walking the earth today. We want to, you know, walk as He would.
So. Yeah, you know, that's an interesting point. Maybe you could clarify, you know, this question that might be in the minds of some people, because I know I've heard this question when people have a quote messianic congregation that they're coming under the law. And I understand the different than that, but maybe you could explain it.
Well, Yeshua is the one that gave the Torah or the words to Moshe, and then when he came on the earth, he came out and lived his Torah, the words, and he showed them how to do it through the power of the Spirit and the specifics of it and not being hung up by man's traditions, which he was very kind of hard on the Pharisees, the Parashim, and Sadducees, the Jewish religious leaders, because they didn't have a heart right for God, and they weren't really serving out of love and adoration for Him, even though they thought maybe they were, they were really too much in the way. It wasn't the words of Yeshua, and then He made it very clear to them.
And it says that it's for all people. Leviticus 23 says, "These are my feasts." It doesn't say Jewish feasts.
Exactly.
It says, "These are my feasts."
Yes.
And so He wants it for all people. And in fact, He encourages people to come to the house of prayer. It's for all nations. Mm-hmm. So it opens it up. Everything He's taught are for all people. In fact, when they left Egypt, all the strangers came with them that wanted to come. So He invites all to come that will come.
Yeah. I was in a church in New York 2 years ago, and a messianic rabbi was there, and we were having a conversation afterwards, and I made a comment to him that Jesus is a Jew. And he says, "Well, that's interesting that you would say that." I said, "Why?" He says, "Well, most people say He was a Jew." Well, He still is. But Jesus is a Jew.
Yes, always will be.
But you know, the early church, they continued celebrating the feast through the early church. So it appears as if to me in the time of Constantine,
exactly,
when we got Easter.
Yeah.
I'm not sure how the bunny got involved in all of that, but I'm sure there's something in the occultic culture that was incorporated into the church that found its way there. But so you know, being part of a messianic congregation doesn't mean you're coming under the law, because we're free from the law.
That's exactly it. Free from man's traditions, for sure. Yeah. That, and you know, every church can have traditions that they do, and others can call that legalism. So,
and you know, the Lord wants us to worship in spirit and in truth, and you know, with the filling of the Holy Spirit, He leads you into all truth.
Yeah.
So.
Well, tell people about your congregation. Now, of course, we've announced this Saturday, but you guys meet every week.
Mm-hmm.
And when and the same location, 86th
yes, uh-huh.
and Lewis 3rd.
Uh-huh.
At 6 p.m. till about 8 or 8:30 on Thursdays, we have intercession for Israel, but for all the nations for any specific needs. But the place where we're meeting is especially dedicated for a house of prayer, and eventually maybe 24/7 prayer and worship.
Praise God.
And so that's our heart, to extend that. And then Friday evening is like the glow of the Shabbat. A lot of people come and just soak in the Lord and worship. Come away from the busy week and just soak. We do a lot of worship and teaching too on the Torah, that portion, and relating it to the New Testament, the New Covenant. But we just so enjoy the freedom to just worship. And then on Shabbat, we concentrate on the children, but we adults learn just as well, and we dig into the depth of the Hebrew, as well as what the scriptures say, as you have the close translations to the Hebrew.
Beginning of the languages, figurative, numerical meanings to the original letters, to see where they came, the meaning came from, the meaning to words, language. So,
well, that's great. So that happens every Friday night.
And Shabbat, we have, of course, a lot of the children come then. We have little etch-a-sketches for them so that they learn how to write the little Hebrew letters and make it fun for them. And they
Now, Shabbat is actually on Saturday.
Yes.
So what happens on Saturday? Is that morning, afternoon, evening?
Afternoon at 3 we start.
Okay.
And we usually start with the children with their little Torah video, and then we do instruction, and Gary gets into the Hebrew and the depth of the word after that. And we have dance instruction. The whole family gets involved in dance. You know, we used to have just a dance team. Well, now we have everybody dancing.
Wow. No bench warmers.
That's right.
People don't get kid, but they choose to be involved. Yeah, the Sabbath begins at sundown the night before.
On Friday night, yeah.
Yeah, because that's the way the Lord established in Genesis 1, and it was evening and morning on the first day, and then all the way through the seventh day. So
people that want to participate, they come on Friday night, and then they come back on Saturday at 3 o'clock and with their kiddos. And if they don't have kiddos, will they still come at 3 or they come later?
At 3.
Yeah.
Yeah, they enjoy it just as much.
Art Linklater was good at enjoying children and for families to watch. So.
And, you know, we have one family especially that teaches a little child the scriptures before she comes. And, I mean, she could teach the adults, this little one. She's only like 6, and she is amazing.
Well, great. This has been so enjoyable. We're going to watch a little video clip here yet. And I think we'll close with that. But anything else you want to add to let people have a more of an understanding to Jewish roots or happening?
I think on Passover, just know that we try to relate all the New Covenant scriptures to it so that you understand the meaning of what we're doing that was done in the Old Covenant. And it's fresh and alive and new. And there'll be an explanation of what we do.
You have the requirements of Passover, but we don't just stay in the Old Testament, and that's a blessing for some Jewish people. They feel more comfortable, but we want to welcome both Jew and Gentile, and so we share all the scriptures as Yeshua would if he was in our place, I believe.
Yes. Well, great. Well, thank you so much for coming to the studio here today. And
thank you for having us. It's really been a blessing.
This is a first. This is the first time we've done Tuesday night call, webinar. I never know what to call it. I often say this, is it a show, is it a presentation, is it a webinar? But this is the first we've done where we're actually recording it here. and they're going to play the video, and then it'll be on YouTube shortly thereafter. But you guys will go down in the Hall of Fame as being the first. So.
Oh, hallelujah.
The Judah
well, thank
goes
you.
First, you and know, favor upon your ministry. Ground.
So I trust everybody has enjoyed Gary and Gloria. And again, you can participate in their activity this coming Saturday at 1 o'clock. And then every Friday night and Saturday as well at 86th and Lewis. But before we sign off here for tonight, let's watch and tell us what we're going to see here.
This is a clip of the last part of the song that we recorded back in 2000, We Remember You, Gary and I and my daughter sang on this. The Lord downloaded a lot of songs, and this was one specific for Passover. And so at the end of this dance, my husband and I dance what I call a bridal dance. At our 30th wedding anniversary, the Lord showed me to pick up a tallit and just start dancing with my husband. And this is the dance that came out of that. But the Holy Spirit just showed the moves as we went. Mm. And it represents Yeshua wrapping his bride in the tallit.
That's right. We're all his bride. Men too.
And tell us, for someone that might not know, what is a tallit and purpose of it?
It's a prayer shawl, and it's likely Yeshua was wearing that, at least some form. It was required for all male Israelites to have some form of tzitzit on the four corners of their garments to recognize that they were of the tribes of Israel.
Mm-hmm.
But really has to do with representing Yeshua's or the Lord's instructions. And so this lady with a woman with issue of blood, which is just in the Torah of late and the teachings, all had her by her faith knew that all she had to do was touch that tzitzit and she would be healed. And that Yeshua said that your faith has healed you.
Yes. So a tallit then is a fabric,
mm-hmm.
3x6 or something like that. Do they vary in size?
Yeah, it could be any size.
Any size.
Yeah.
It's got the four corners that you put the tzitzit on.
Okay. And there's something about they're braided with multiple colors or something as well?
Blue and white.
The blue thread represents Yeshua running through the instructions.
And that goes back to the Old Testament, though. Right. I mean it's symbolism again.
Yeah, a little symbolic of dried blood, really, of the mollusk, which they've been finding now around the Mediterranean again. It had been gone for a long time, but now they're finding that, and that's where they get the dye for. To color the tzitzit.
So then Jewish custom, Hebrew custom would be for men to have a tallit when and where?
They could, but it's a holy garment, so you probably don't want to get it dirty and lay it on the floor.
For Shabbat.
Right. You can do it for that or pray under as a covering, symbolic of the Lord's protection over us.
Okay.
So, and we're not discriminatory either. We allow anybody to use that, male, female, different ages. So.
So in the video we're about to see, though, you have a long one.
Yeah.
That you're using for the bridal dance. Mm-hmm. All right. Let's watch it.
All right.
All righty. Enjoy. Praise God. I trust again that this was an encouragement to you and help you to understand what's really going on, or what's going on at least in the Messianic world as we celebrate Passover. And thank you again for the opportunity you've given us here to speak into your life. And I encourage you to participate. If you're watching this on YouTube, I encourage you to check us out every Tuesday night. You can join in live, and you can do that by calling in on any phone, or you can use the Start Meeting app. The information's on your screen here now, and we'd love to have you join us. Tell your friends about it, and if you would, like us on Facebook. We're believing to get to 1,000 likes, and we're adding some every week, and also appreciate you to subscribe to our YouTube channel. And by subscribing, every time we add a new video, you'll get an email that there's a new video being posted. So thank you again for your partnership. Thank you for your prayers. And for those of you that do partner with the ministry, we do have a special program where we are giving you the Supernatural Discipleship Level 1 absolutely free of charge. So more information on that below. Check it out. And be blessed. Have yourself a glorious week, and we'll see you here again next Tuesday.